Welcome to another episode of the Books of Some Substance podcast. This is David.
And this is Eric.
And on this episode, Eric and I will be discussing the two adaptations of Solaris, the 1972 Tarkovsky film and the 2002 Soderbergh film. First, before we talk about the films, what do we think about film adaptations from novel source material?
Well, I'm not against them, per se, but I think that I will admit personally for me that film adaptations rarely transcend their literary sources, I would argue. But then again, I think it's being very savvy about what kind of novels, or I guess it could be anything, memoirs, whatever, one chooses to adapt. I heard a quote somewhere about that filmmakers should really adapt mediocre novels because it gives them room to kind of really improve and and create something new. And I actually liked the novel Solaris a fair amount, I have to say, probably more than you and Nick did.
Yeah.
But I think this, out of all the kind of comparisons I've done between novels and their filmic adaptations, this triumvirate of the two films and the novel actually was a lot more interesting a field to investigate than maybe anything else I've really thought about in this category in a long time.
Yeah. I know when I was younger, I used to compare them a lot more. When I used to look at adaptations, I used to think about what the director's choices were, how they failed or succeeded in adapting something. And the older I get, the less I care about that, the more I think of it as its own sort of unique piece of artwork, or at least that's how I try to do it.
Yeah, I think, you know, to me, the part that's always the stumbling block, I think, is that at least a lot of my favorite novels, the sort of internal voice is a very important element, right? And to sort of translate that into the sort of, you know, the world of film, the mise-en-scène of film, which requires a little bit more of this creation of a world that we believe to be real, because it's just a lot more immediate, a lot more literal when we see things on screen, as opposed to when we read words, where I think we're filling in the blanks a lot more, and then thus much more willing to forgive this kind of what I would call psychological internal dialogue dimension, right, where it can get very contrived very quickly. I think about the voiceovers, you know, in the original cut of Blade Runner, you know, they were just kind of lame especially when you saw the director's cut later on. And I think bridging that gap from often literature to film is hard to bridge. And I think what's interesting about Solaris as a book is that I think there is some of that there, but, and we can get into this more, but seeing the two films and reading the novel, you begin to see these kind of ways that Lem and Soderbergh and Tarkovsky are using this kind of source material to both get at maybe different things and to approach it in a much different way. And the book for me was, I began to see it as a much more cerebral exercise in comparison to the two films. And I think when filmmakers kind of grab something and go, well, there's something here, but I'm going to bend it a little bit more to speak of things that maybe I think are important and really push the film language to do that, I think that's when adaptations get a lot more interesting and transcend their source material. And I think that in both of the films, not all successfully, I think do that in their own ways.
I agree. And you could tell each film version is taking an aspect or two from the novel. And really, what I think in both films are pushing questions more than answers. They're investigating these sort of philosophical ideas more than anything else, which is in keeping with what Lem does in most of his writing as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think to credit to Lem, and that the really the core premise of the original book is a very, you know, fascinating one, right? We get to this planet, and this planet conjures things in our minds that become real. And in the case of Chris, you know, his wife who had killed herself, I mean, that's a very, we talked about this in the club too, that's a very compelling idea of like what happens when this thing comes back and you have the chance to sort of ask maybe the questions you wanted of the actual person, not only of yourself, but the actual person. I mean, there's a very compelling idea at the core of the book that I think allows for a lot of different ways to interpret. And the source material is very rich in that respect, and could that's why it could sustain, I think, two filmic adaptions. One, I think, very, to me, very good. One, fairly good, but not great. You know, but I feel like it's the kind of source material that could sustain probably multiple adaptations and still yield interesting and fresh results.
I think that has to do with the openness of the novel. There's no set answers to things. And I think that's what makes it so open to interpretation and adaptation.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned one you thought was great and one good but not great. Go ahead and tell us which one was which.
Well, it's interesting. I saw the original 72 Tarkovsky film about 20 plus years ago at the Castro, and I remember sort of it being a bit of a slog for me then, and I was a little bit hesitant to revisit it, I think, even though I enjoyed and was surprised by how much I enjoyed the book. And I think it was just timing. I think Tarkovsky, I mean, this is really the only film that I've seen by him. I've assigned this film director in a class that I teach where students take a film director and they kind of build a design program around a fictional festival of that director. And I remember when I assigned Tarkovsky, the student came back to me and she goes, "Have you seen the films, you know, that of this director?" And I said, "Just Solaris." And she's like, "Yeah, you should maybe watch a few more of these films." And I just never got around to it. And now I feel like Tarkovsky's coming back a little bit with the re-release of Stalker on Criterion. And so I'm excited to revisit it. But going back to Solaris, I think, you know, I knew it was 3 hours long. I remember sitting down and the film, I have to say, grabbed me from the beginning. It still has this very kind of glacial pace and the special effects and the styling is definitely that sort of period future.
Retro-futurism.
Yeah, retro-futurism, good word for it. I think maybe it's because of the age we live in, or just my own age, being able to kind of maybe process things better. But the sort of languid pace, the very philosophical underpinnings of the whole investigation that Tarkovsky does, even the way Tarkovsky wields a camera, I just began to really appreciate it the second time around. And I have to say, I watched it after work on like a Wednesday night thinking I wouldn't be able to get through it. And I was rapt the whole way through it. And it's hard to really explain. I think maybe it's really about the way Tarkovsky, he has a strong vision of, regardless of the source material, of what he thinks film should do, both in its ideas and I think both in its formal realization of it. And I really appreciated that vision, even if, you know, if we really dig in deep into the details, maybe it was a little too long in places. Maybe he did start to explain a little bit more. But I feel like he, both in terms of the way he reformatted the actual plot, like the way that the Burton sequence is not this long kind of
interview.
Yeah, interview. Yeah, it becomes this kind of integral part of the movie. The way he brought these much more, these allusions to other sort of works, whether it was the Don Quixote or the Bruegel painting, or I mean, I just enjoyed that he expanded on the original source material in very creative and I thought vivid ways. And by the end, I was, you know, pretty wowed. I mean, maybe you want to give your response to this film and then we can talk about the second one.
Yeah. So some of the things you pointed out are very intriguing to me. Take the Burton section. When I watched that scene, all of a sudden I began thinking about the director's, his sort of entrapment in Soviet filmmaking. And the way he interpreted that scene from the book felt very much a Soviet bureaucratic interpretation of the scene. So we get all these sort of like bureaucrats in different areas having this conference call.
Right.
Which I really enjoyed that scene, actually. It was one of my favorite little scenes in that movie.
Me too.
Yeah. But you're right. There is a glacial pace to his films. And I'm just glad you don't assign Bellatar movies to your students because that would be torture.
But yeah, I draw the line there.
Yeah. Yeah. And so when I first saw the film in full, because the first time I tried to watch it, I fell asleep actually in a basement at like, you know, midnight. Someone's like, "Oh, we should check this out." So the first time I watched the film was a few years after that, and I really enjoyed it. And as time has gone forward, I've watched more of his movies, and I think his methods and his investigation of ideas, which is really what I think he does best, I think it comes out better in other films. And I think this one sort of meanders a bit. And you mentioned it makes reference to Dostoevsky, Tolstoy, Don Quixote, the Bruegel painting, all these other ideas. And I feel like it does that. It relies on that too much, almost to the point where it's not really adding. It's just asking more questions, which could be good, could be bad, depending on maybe the mood you're in. But it felt to me like it was constantly trying to make note of itself almost. And it didn't feel lived in the way that I think the Soderbergh movie actually does a little better, where I really get a better sense of the characters. They are in that moment wrestling with these ideas, not just thinking about them.
I think that's a great, actually good criticism. I think you're right that the Soderbergh version does create a more holistic world that you believe, I think, where the Tarkovsky film could almost feel like a play to a certain degree. So I think in terms of actually, you know, creating that world that you believe, the Soderbergh one is certainly better. But it's interesting how the fundamental plot of Solaris, where these people are on this space station, they're kind of going crazy and they're just asking questions of what is going on here. I think at least that foundational plot allows me to be more forgiving of the meandering. Like, I really felt in the Tarkovsky one that I was going a little crazy with them. You know, whereas the Soderbergh one, I felt a little bit at a distance. Like, I was watching from Earth below and seeing this stuff happen. And so while maybe on paper the sort of, you know, structurally the Tarkovsky one meanders a bit, it certainly puts you in the place of those characters, I think, a bit better than the Soderbergh one does.
See, I disagree. I think the Soderbergh puts you in that emotional state better, whereas the Tarkovsky film puts you in the questioning. You are more thinking about these ideas.
Yeah, to segue a little bit into the Soderbergh one, I think, you know, I think you're right. I think from an emotional standpoint, I was definitely much more enveloped in the Soderbergh one. And I think that it's funny, my wife was watching both of the films intermittently over my shoulder, and she made the comment. She was just like, the Tarkovsky thing was just crazy. I don't really know what was going on there. But by the end of the Soderbergh one, I think she stuck around for the end of that. It really affected me emotionally. I think the comment that I made, and maybe the reason I don't like the Soderbergh one as much as it did, I think, get to me emotionally more, was that what happens is in the quest to do that, it becomes for me a bit more about a familiar love story maybe, and a little less about the big ideas. And so the Soderbergh one becomes a little more less idiosyncratic and interesting to me as a story and even as a film.
Yeah.
But it is an interesting debate. And I do remember, I've seen both the films once before. And I remember I saw the remake of Solaris in the theaters and remember coming out going like, wow, that was a lot better than I really expected it to be, considering the original source material and where this thing comes from. And I don't know I think it's diminished a little bit the second time, whereas the second time seeing the Tarkovsky one, I'm like, oh, wow, this is a lot more interesting than I remember it being. And the longevity of things, and can they sustain multiple viewings? Maybe that's the reason the Tarkovsky one still has a lot more weight, because as you watch it more and more, it reveals more, whereas the Soderbergh one, on my second viewing, I began to see these holes as things that really undermine the film, holes like the acting. I just didn't feel like Clooney or McElhone could really, they didn't have the chops to kind of communicate the tragic weight of that story to me.
Really? Okay.
And then that weird gotcha plot twist at the end of the Soderbergh one that wasn't in the book or the original Tarkovsky one, with the Snow character, I thought was just like James Cameron, you know, the producer going in and going, dude, this is so boring. Can you throw in a plot twist? You know, and
see, I enjoyed that mostly because I liked Jeremy Davies' gesticulating weirdness.
Well, that was an inspired casting. I did like that. It just felt like they were trying to throw something in there to kind of make it more exciting. And that really bummed me out.
That's actually one thing that I thought was underdeveloped, because that is one of the few instances where Solaris brings a, or I guess you could say, personifies the own person. Like, he created a version of himself.
Right.
And to me, that is something that could have been a lot more interesting.
Yeah, I think that's my point. It's an interesting idea. And it was just like, what? You know, I don't know. I think you're right that it is an interesting idea, but it just was so underdeveloped.
It's a throwaway. Yeah.
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 And the way it was revealed just felt like, oh, it's almost like a horror film. Oh my God, he's dead. What do we do? You know, it just felt out of place. Too little, too late.
Yeah. And there's parts of the Soderbergh film that are very underdeveloped. And in terms of the love story, to me, I view that as the sort of structure in which he builds to these other ideas, which, because of the pacing, maybe are not as developed. These questions of redemption, these questions of what is it we really want. And there's that quote in the 2002 film, the quote is, "We don't want other worlds, we want mirrors." In the 1972 film and the book, it's, "We don't want other worlds, we need mirrors." Now, that could be a translation thing, but
true.
Those two words seemed so pivotal in terms of what maybe they're trying to do. Maybe I'm overthinking that, but
yeah, we might be, but I think it's indicative of maybe the times a little bit, where I think when Solaris came out, even if he was in Russia doing this, there was a, I don't know, the times were a little bit more tumultuous. Maybe things were a little bit more unclear about where the world was going, you know, late 60s, early 70s.
Oh, yeah. The fact that he was from Russia is part of it. It's this fact that we're looking outward. There's, you know, the space race is still going on. The Cold War is still heavy. This idea of global instability, this idea that maybe we need to look within is something that is needed. And in the 2002 film, it's more of a critique on selfishness or solipsism, that we want to look within because that's somehow comforting or easy. I don't know.
It's also the dawn of the internet age, too,
yeah,
you know, where things have become more about, you know, I just want to sort of, you know, see myself reflected in my blogging at this point, or my, you know, my selfies that were yet to come. I mean, it's interesting to think about how the times really influence and the where you were when you made it. I mean, as someone who's in Russia as opposed to the United States, I mean, it's something I didn't ponder too much when I thought about this, but that quote does begin to crack open a lot of interesting things around the times and the place of when each of the movies were made.
And let me go to another quote and ask you a question. So the quote comes from the Soderbergh film, and it's during the Jabberian sort of dream puppet master sequence when he says, "There are no answers, only choices." And to me, that quote really is the philosophical drive of the Soderbergh film. We are the choices we make and the choices we repeat, the choices we make determining who we are. And I think that is the sort of core philosophical idea of the film. But I'm not sure if there is a single drive of the Tarkovsky film, which, again, maybe that makes it more interesting, more open, because there's a lot of different questions. Do you feel that the Tarkovsky film has one key thing that it's sort of driving at? It's hard for me to see it, and maybe I need to watch the film again, but...
Yeah, I would say maybe I need to watch it again. And I want to, for our listeners, you know, the Tarkovsky film is almost 3 hours. The Soderbergh one is barely over an hour and a half. So it's interesting how, you know, one is twice the length of the other. And, you know, I think part of it is the demands of the filmmaker and the marketplace to a certain degree, but also the length of the Tarkovsky film allows it to meander a bit more, whereas I think the Soderbergh one is a lot more compact, for better or for worse. In terms of that actual quote, I mean, it's interesting. When I saw the ending of the Tarkovsky one, I was like, is it implying that he's just still on the planet and he's just decided to recreate this whole world of his father's house and where he grew up? And then after I saw the second one, I was, yeah, that's what it is. You know, because it seems very deliberate at the end of... I mean, no spoiler alert here, anybody who hasn't seen them. But and this is, I think, something we should discuss maybe finally is the different endings of the film. But by the time I finished the Soderbergh one, I was like, oh yeah, that's what Tarkovsky was doing. But then again, I'm not really sure. I mean, I think that you're right. It's also just the filmmaker style, and that I think Tarkovsky does intentionally kind of throw you off into all these different cul-de-sacs and different questions, and never really brings it home into a deliberate, like, this is what we're talking about, whereas the Soderbergh one does. And I think Soderbergh delivers on that quote a lot more than maybe Tarkovsky does, but does that make it a little less interesting? You know, certainly the reveal of the end of the Tarkovsky one, you know, he's back home and that weird kind of like rain in the inside of the house, and then they pull back and you're like, okay. Whereas the Soderbergh one, it's pretty devastating. Like, you realize, oh, wow, the weight of what's happening here. I think I felt it a lot more.
Yeah.
Does it linger? I don't know. But I certainly felt it in that moment a lot more than I felt it at the end of the Tarkovsky one. Mm.
The Soderbergh ending certainly brings home that idea more, that he is given a choice either to return home, live a life that will be known unhappily, but known, or embrace this idea of the unknown and whatever happens when the ship crashes into the planet. But yeah, the Tarkovsky film, you don't really know that this is a choice he's even considering. You know, right. There's something going on in his head near the end of the film where he's talking about, you know, I'm finally happy. There's like a line like that just before the end sequence when he's at the frozen lake. And the strange thing, the one that makes the Tarkovsky film a little confusing in the end, is that the manifestation of his dead wife is paramount to his experience on the ship. And yet in the end, it's his father who he embraces. And
exactly.
I don't understand that at all. Did you?
No, that was the one hiccup in that film that I still am a little confused about, and maybe it's not resolved. Maybe you're right. I think that when you begin to parse the Tarkovsky one a little bit more, especially since you've seen some of the other films, it seems like he didn't quite square the circle, so to speak. And
it's clear that he's on Solaris, that it has enveloped him wholly. And in the Tarkovsky film, I actually think the purpose of Solaris is stronger. It's more clear. It starts creating these islands after it has learned what it wanted to learn from these people. Because, and to me, this goes back to the Bruegel, the painting, where from its time, there was this big idea in landscape paintings that landscapes must be populated with people because that is what gives the landscape meaning. So there's this focus in the Tarkovsky film moving through that painting, and it's like this wandering eye over the landscape of the painting, sort of like taking it in, trying to understand what it's seeing. It's a very weird little scene that I kind of loved. But by the end of the film, when Solaris starts to create these islands, I started to think about, oh, it's trying to understand these people so that it can populate itself in some way, that it needs some life form. And maybe this is Tarkovsky's religious questioning of what does our purpose serve? And maybe it even goes to the question of our choices, but it's this creation of human existence in order to find meaning in some way.
Yeah, well, I think in the different ways we do that, I think the contrast of that Bruegel painting with the world of Solaris is that, yeah, the painting is, Bruegel's paintings are a little, and this is the guy who did the Tower of Babel painting too, but the landscapes are always a little bit uneasy. But what was interesting to drop that painting into the film was that there is this richness of life that when they were sort of panning across the different details of the painting, you know, you begin to see this sort of like, oh, there's these people inhabiting what seems to be a very rich sort of landscape, or at least a human earthbound one.
And even in the dead of winter, it's brimming with life.
Yeah, and you contrast that to what's going on on Solaris, the sort of just cold, empty plots of space. And these guys are here in the interest of science to understand things. And I don't know, maybe it's just because of what I do. It's sort of almost positioned between this art and science world, design being that way. I found that really interesting in the sense that, you know, do we sometimes pursue these sort of these scientific ideas and pursuits at the expense of life and art? And you know, what's the balance? What's the sort of choice? What's the, you know, how do we, what does make a world, you know, a rich world, a lived in world, is a very interesting question in the context of this film, right? Because the planet's trying to understand that. These guys are, it's like pushing themselves to the limit of scientific exploration to kind of further our understanding. In some ways, it asks the question, you know, what, are both of those things important? At the end of the day, is it really about us being in a place that's lived in with our loved ones and the people that we, in a world that we live in and the people we love? Is that the important thing? I mean, there's just some, this is what I mean. It's just the Tarkovsky thing just takes you down these labyrinths and cul-de-sacs of questions where your head starts to hurt. Whereas the Soderbergh one does too, but it's always within the context of this core, you know, relationship between Chris and Rhea.
Yeah. For me, that anchor, I think, makes it better.
The Soderbergh film.
Yeah. Because I like having that structure in which to investigate these other questions.
It makes it a tighter film, for sure.
Yeah. As a piece of narrative storytelling, I think the Soderbergh film is better. As an experience and as an admirer of technique, I think I like the Tarkovsky film a little better.
Yeah, and resonant, too. I think, you know, I like Soderbergh as a filmmaker, but he's a real, what I would call, he's more in the spirit of those 40s and 50s, just really good filmmakers, but they're not auteurs. They're not pushing a vision. They're just really trying to make a great film with the material that they have. So I think what's very interesting to me is that Soderbergh almost merged this kind of, he has the ability to make these really tight, technically accomplished films with this more auteurist vision of this source material. And I think it does deliver on both of those things that he's always done as a filmmaker, or at least a filmmaker as late. Certainly his early films, I think, were much more sort of auteurish or experimental, Sex, Lies, and Videotape being the first one. But yeah, at the end of the day, does it resonate as much? And I think that for me, 5-6 days on, the Tarkovsky film is resonating with me more as a piece of art than the Soderbergh one, even though at the end of the Soderbergh one, I felt the weight of that relationship much, much more. And so it's sort of, which thing do you find more valuable? And I guess, you know, through this discussion, I'm liking seeing the flaws in the Tarkovsky one more and maybe appreciating the Soderbergh one more, maybe back to where I saw it the first time. But it's still a question to me. And maybe it's just a question of what you hold dear when you devour culture of this ilk, you know.
Yeah.
And for me, it's both.
Yeah, it's both. I love and appreciate both of them in different ways. And I actually think both are rewatchable.
Yeah, totally. Anyway, I think it's a testament to all three of them that they are works of art that do still stick with us and leave us with questions. And it's a matter of how many questions is too many questions.
Yeah.
Right. And I think some people like things that are more open-ended and maybe – I mean, I have a friend who's – he and I approach art from such different places. I think he comes at it from a much more intellectual, cerebral place, and I come at it from a much more feeling, emotional place, at least initially. And I think what's great about the source material and these three visions of it is that it shows you all these different – how a piece of art, a really good piece of art, can – be approached in all those ways and still yield a really great experience and still linger. Maybe if we look at this Solaris investigation, these three pieces as a whole, rather than three pieces, it becomes a very rich overall experience. And that's pretty exciting.
Yeah. I think you kind of nailed it there.
It takes me a little bit, but I appreciate that these works and these discussions can crystallize those things for me and hopefully for other people as well. People listening, I hope.
Thanks for listening, everybody. You can follow us on Twitter or Instagram at BooksOSubstance. Find us online at BooksOfSomeSubstance.com. And if you'd like to help us out, please rate us on iTunes or wherever you happen to listen and share it. Next month, we'll be back with another book of some substance. Until then, peace.